Good morning. We start with breaking news unfolding in Canberra right now and straight to our federal politics reporter, Kerry Axley. Kerry, good morning. The government has just had a win.
Yeah, it has, Davina. Just in the last few minutes, the Senate has voted to repeal Medevac legislation after the government secured Jackie Lambie's crucial vote. Senator Lambie was in tears as she told the chamber that she can't tell us what she asked for from the government in order to secure her support to repeal the legislation. She said making it would compromise national security. And just as a reminder, Parliament passed the Medevac legislation before the last election against the government's will. It allowed for two doctors to give the green light for the transfer of asylum seekers in offshore detention to the Australian mainland for medical treatment. The minister could overrule the transfer, but only on security grounds, and the government made no secret of the fact that it wanted this legislation gone. This morning, in a fiery Senate debate, the opposition accused the coalition of operating in secrecy. Senate leader Matthias Cormann said that there was no secret deal with Senator Lambie, which sounded a little different from what Senator Lambie herself had to say.
My hand is on my heart, and I can stand here and say that I would be putting at risk Australia's national security and national interest if I said anything else about this.
There is no secret deal. Let me repeat that again. There is no secret deal. There is no secret. The Australian people know extremely well the work that we have done to strengthen our border protection arrangements.
This ultimately is not just about the substance, it is about the role of this chamber. And it is about whether policy can be made in the shadows or whether it is subjected to some sunlight.
Approximately 180 asylum seekers had been transferred via Medevac since the 2nd of March. Davina, all of them are still in Australia. Repealing this legislation is a much-needed win for the government in the Senate after One Nation surprised everyone last Thursday and voted against the government's union-busting bill.
It is big news in Canberra this morning, Kerry. Thank you. Well, the stage is set for NATO summit fireworks in London, with US President Donald Trump already upsetting several leaders. Here's our correspondent, Sophie Walsh.
Well, they appear to be one big happy family tonight. An official photo has been released of the NATO alliance's 29 members posing, smiling alongside the Queen. But the reality is there are deep divisions within this military alliance. Donald Trump didn't help the situation today, launching a scathing attack on French President Emmanuel Macron after he labelled NATO brain dead.
It's a very, very nasty statement. Just can't go around making statements like that about NATO. It's very disrespectful.
UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson also appeared to do everything in his power to avoid the US president, leaving him out in the cold outside Downing Street with carolers, as well as refusing to take part in bilateral talks or even posing for one of those handshake moments. Tonight's 70th anniversary celebrations at Buckingham Palace were also overshadowed by anti-Trump protesters who tried to break down a police barrier and disrupt the event inside. Among the royal guests tonight, the Queen, Prince Charles and Camilla and the Duchess of Cambridge, but one notable absence was Prince Andrew, who was snubbed from tonight's event in light of that disastrous TV interview on Jeffrey Epstein. Donald Trump was asked what he thought of the matter today. This is what he said.
I don't know Prince Andrew, but it's a tough story.
Although all it takes is a very simple Google image search and you find multiple occasions where the Prince and the President were actually side by side. The summit heads to Watford tomorrow, which is about an hour's drive from London, where organisers hope that protesters don't follow.
Meanwhile, in Washington, the president has been accused of undermining national security and obstructing justice in a scathing 300-page document. The House Intelligence Committee's impeachment report says Mr. Trump put his personal interests above the United States in the alleged dealings with Ukraine.
I am gravely concerned that if we merely accept this, that we invite not only further corruption of our elections by this president, but we also invite it of the next president.
House committee members will now vote on that report. We'll go to breaking news now, and former NRL star Jared Mullen has just pleaded guilty to one count of supplying cocaine in a Newcastle court. Mullen, who played for the Newcastle Knights and represented New South Wales in the state of origin, had three other charges withdrawn by prosecutors. He'll be sentenced in February next year. A woman has been sexually assaulted while jogging along a popular trail in Melbourne's north. This report from Neary Tai.
Well, police divers are preparing to search a creek here in Coburg after a woman was sexually assaulted. Sex crime squad detectives are remaining rather tight-lipped on this investigation, but what we do know is that a young woman was jogging here last night when she was grabbed from behind and sexually assaulted.
Me and my girlfriend's like, we won't go out at night because we don't feel safe.
The victim managed to flee, running to a nearby food outlet to find help. She was taken to hospital.
I don't think I'd be coming down here at night time, but during the day there's so many people here that I haven't had an issue with it so far.
Forensic police spent hours combing the crime scene, bagging evidence next to the track and bushes. A pair of boots were also taken away as evidence.
It hurts, you know, like I'm a young woman, I like to exercise, I want to feel safe wherever I go.
A 25-year-old man from Coburg was arrested around 1:30 this morning. He remains in police custody.
Let's go to breaking news in Sydney's west now, where a 300-tonne mobile crane has flipped onto its side at a Parramatta construction site. The crane operator managed to remove himself from the cab of the crane, which spilled fluid onto Phillips Street. The collapse causing damage to a building. Thankfully, no one was seriously injured, but the incident is now being investigated by Safe Work New South Wales. And investigators are looking into whether arson was behind the bushfires that threatened homes in Sydney's west. Blazes at Cranbrook and Londonderry erupted late yesterday, destroying at least one shed as crews battled to control the flames. Both fires remain at a Watch and Act level today. Let's go to Fiona Willen on the New South Wales South Coast now, where authorities are warning wind gusts could whip up more fire danger, forcing residents to take shelter.
The fire's been downgraded to Watch and Act this morning, but there are fears it could flare up again this afternoon. I wanted to show you it from this angle because it gives a sense of the impact that it's having on the coastal communities here. Last night, when it was at emergency level, it started to reach some coastal areas. It's not yet known if any homes were lost, but firefighters were working hard to protect them. Areas from Borley Point to Depot Beach were affected. A number of people were gathered here at the beach overnight watching things unfold. One man was so scared he actually left his bike over there because he was afraid that the fire would reach here and that it would be destroyed.
Just purely because pride and joy, and I don't want it to disappear.
So yeah, you do have concerns about...
Oh yeah, no, we have concerns that it's going to hit here. Where everyone in town's set up, ready to go. Like, as soon as we see flame, we're all meeting down here at the boat ramp.
At first you think it's one of the most beautiful sights you've ever seen. But then you go, what's it going to mean? So you kind of swing between that. It's a stunning thing to see, but it's just so angry and you just get afraid.
The advice for people from Kiola to Durris North, if you are in those areas today, it is too late to leave. You need to take shelter if the fire approaches. While conditions have eased on the fire ground this morning, wind is of concern because if that picks up again, this fire could take off again later today.
And these bushfires are creating hazardous air quality conditions over Sydney as smoke blows in from more than 100 blazes burning across the state. Today's air rating is poor and the haze is expected to linger as temperatures reach into the low 30s in parts of the city. People with heart and lung conditions are being told to take extra precautions. We'll go to Jess Millwood now in Queensland, where residents are bracing for days of unrelenting heat, prompting health warnings from authorities.
Well, we're into day three now of these really severe, very hot conditions. 38 degrees is the forecast for here in Ipswich today, 39 for tomorrow, 41 for Friday and Saturday. In fact, it won't dip below 35 degrees for at least a week. Yesterday in Brisbane City, we saw a top of 35.2 and 36 is the forecast for today. These prolonged, very severe, hot conditions have prompted this warning from authorities.
We do usually see an increase in number of patients, and interestingly, not always with heat-related illness. Often the heat exacerbates other conditions as well.
More than likely have extra shifts on, we'll have extra people here in the communication centre to deal with those. If you're starting to suffer, make sure you either seek help from another health professional, whether that's a GP or the ambulance service as well. Never hesitate to call 000 if you are feeling unwell.
Of course, now a timely reminder to keep an eye on the elderly, also children and pets. Around 50 fires continue to burn across the state of Queensland. Thankfully, the winds won't be too bad today, but fire crews are keeping a very close eye on them, ready to go to any flare-ups across the state.